probably just over a minute away from 15 kilometres, and that's Dora on the near side of Germany. And the pedigree athletes now are gathering at the front. There's a fair amount of experience there and a lot of success. Thought for a moment the flag dropping there marked the 15k, but it doesn't. We're not quite there yet. Kilometres and about 53.04, Brendan.
Well, that's about 2:29 pace, and that means they've slightly increased their pace there. Wanda Panfil moving along, moving into the lead, just to get in a good position for the feed stations. And it looks to be quite an efficient feeding station here. Rosa Moda got her drink quite neatly. They probably recognize her because they've seen some of her great races, both on television and when she did run in Japan. But look at the amount of water they're taking on board. They're drinking from just the regular water. They're taking their own bottles. Iris Bieber of Germany running just slightly faster than she's ever run before. And Wanda Panfil, well, she had enough of that, and she threw it onto the side. And the three Japanese. Ari Mori there, looking controlled. Got enough water as she wanted at the feed station, and just settling in behind Rosa Moda and Catherine Dora.
Fiber on the near side of Germany. Fiber 27. Her best time just over 2 hours 30, so she's inside that time in very difficult conditions. Okay, Brendan, can you give us the splits, the times on 5, 10 and 15? How even are they?
17:56 for the first 5 kilometres, and then round about the same time for the second 5 kilometres, 35:36 through 10 kilometres, and then 53:07 at 15 kilometres, and that's actually about 2:29 and a half. But I wouldn't be at all surprised, Lisa, if the first part of the race was just to get them in the position, and the second part of the race, somebody will decide to do something about it.
I think it's possible that when someone does decide to take off, perhaps Rosa, Wanda Panfil, whoever, that we could see a race with a negative split here. I think they're all just biding their time. This race will only start somewhere in the second half. In championship races like this, you just want to get the first half out of the way, and then you think about the race really beginning, and we could see a negative split here.
Fiber's looking very strong and quite aggressive on the near side.
She does look good, but with a personal best of 2:30 plus, and they're already under 2:30 pace in these very hot, humid conditions, it would be a surprise to see her there near the end. I wouldn't expect it, unless she is going to run the best race of her life, which is possible.
Today's the day to do it, the World Championship.
I just feel from looking at those split times that they're just easing themselves into the race. The first 5 kilometres, as I said, 17:56. The second 5 kilometres, 17:40. And the third 5 kilometres, 17:30. So as they're becoming more confident with themselves and the conditions, so the pace is just gradually increasing. It's not excessive by any means, but nor should it be. It's a championship race, it's about medals. There's no prizes for times, and I'd be surprised if very many of them in that leading group were even interested in the times, apart from they didn't want to go too fast. Well, they haven't gone too fast, and that leading group of 12, you said earlier that the winner is going to come from there. Well, I think if you look down the field, you'll see once they go off the pack, they seem to be in trouble.
Actually, Lisa, once you lose touch in a distance race, it's almost impossible to get back, isn't it?
It's impossible unless the people ahead, unless something goes wrong with them and they really, really slow down. Once you lose touch, it's psychologically defeating. And in the marathon, you can be 20 metres or 30 metres back, but you're just completely out of contact. It looks a lot further when you're back there than it does on TV. The TV angles can be really deceiving sometimes.
the marathon in terms of kilometres, 42 kilometres. And there's not a natural turning point on this course, by the way. It's an artificial one. Swing across the road, take a sharp right, and back they go. And that's the, oh, Bogley out, one of the most experienced marathon runners in the world. Second in two European Championships, sixth in the 83 World Championship, but now a spectator. And that's a sign of the conditions without any doubt.
I would expect to see a lot of DNFs in this race. There's going to be a high dropout race because of the conditions. And I think that when girls of Laura's caliber lose touch and realize that they're just not with the lead group, they're not in with a chance of a medal, they're going to wonder why should they continue. And I would be surprised if we don't see quite a few more of those.
It's quite marked how some athletes can handle these conditions, others just can't live with them.
It's unfortunate if you are an athlete who cannot run well in warm conditions, because as we were talking before, that's how these championship races are run. The Olympic Games, Los Angeles in 84, Seoul in 88, Barcelona in 92. And if you're a runner who just can't handle warm conditions, that's bad luck, because you're not going to have much luck at championship races. I think Alberto Salazar of the United States was one of those athletes who realized that he just couldn't handle them. And then that became a psychological problem for him too.
That's Machado of Portugal. He's about 30 metres behind that leading group. And by the way, the last shot we saw there, Rottenberg of Norway, so long in the forefront, is losing contact with the leading group. And I think there's about 10 now. That's the two Italians out. 4-4-4, Villani. Stomach cramps for the look of it.
I think that is a real sign of the conditions. But when they start dropping out, and when some of the other athletes notice it, it's amazing what effect that has. You look on the side of the road, you see your Italian teammate, and then it's all of a sudden that goes through your mind. And once you start considering dropping out, then there's a short step between the first thought and the actuality. That leading group of 10, Bieber of Germany, Wanda Panfil of Poland, Rosa Mota, the three Japanese, Araki, Yamahita, and Arimori, Panfil, Rasmussen, Yegorova, and Dora. And the winner is going to come from that group. Cecil Grottenberg now begins to struggle, goes off the back of the pack, and when that happens, that's it. There's another Polish athlete there, that's Gradas of Poland. So that group of 10, they've just whittled themselves down, and that's it. 10 to choose from.
Something rather odd there, Lisa, because Rosa Mota didn't go to the official feeding station to collect water. She got something from the other side of the road.
I wish I'd been watching that one more closely. Perhaps her coach is there, perhaps he gets there before her, grabs a sponge and goes over to the other side so that she can get it without having to fight the other girls for the sponges. I'm not sure, because the cameras didn't allow us to see it really closely, but we'll watch the next one.
Noticeable there that Yegorova lost some ground at the feeding station. But again, Rosa Mota, that very good close-up showing she's hardly breaking sweat.
She's hardly breaking sweat, but wherever you see Rosa, you see Wanda Pample right on her shoulder, and she looks pretty good too. The water stations in the marathon do become places where people can get a break on the others. Someone's concentrating trying to grab a sponge, and someone may ignore that station and go ahead. And as we saw Rosa there, she was on the other side of the road. I don't think the girls were aware what was happening.
So I think the silver medalist from the European Championships, the girl who ran Rosa Mota to 7 seconds in those European Championships in Split last summer, Yegorova, I think she's paying for that early pace now, and I think she's beginning to struggle. She's slipped off the back of the group, and that's it. She's lost a few yards at the feeding station, but she doesn't seem to be able to close it. And they're not going excessively fast at this stage. It's just a gradual wearing down.
Out of the back, Machado of Portugal, working hard to get to them, but she's got a big job on. I think I doubted the Yegorova in the green shorts, who's now back with them. lost a bit of ground at the feeding station. Of course, when you're searching for your own bottle, and you want your own mixture, and you don't get it first time, it breaks the stride pattern.
It can be difficult. Whenever you break your stride pattern, you lose momentum. It's hard to get it back, and the further that the race goes on, the more difficult it is. It's almost like having to stop and get going again.
Biber of Germany. Behind her is Yamashita of Japan. The Japanese are still there, the whole team, three of them. Biber, running faster than she's ever run before, looks to be stretching them out a little bit. Yamashita accepting the challenge. But Panfil glued to Rosa Motor's back.
Panfil glued to Rosa, and I notice Rosa looking across at Biber as if she's not quite sure who that girl is.
Well, Biber's not the most elegant mover, but she certainly looks very strong. And interesting there, I think that's Machado, who's, what is, there's another Portuguese just on the edge of the shot, and we've not got the shot there. We haven't seen with this leading group, or not identified, been tucked at the back of them.
I think that's Machado of Portugal, whose best time of 2 hours and 33 minutes, so she's running faster than she's ever run before. She was 10th in this year's Boston Marathon, which we heard earlier was a fast one, but she's done well there because she came from a long way back. She started obviously very, very cautiously, which has been obviously the quite sensible thing to do, and now she's at the back of the group, and then she's putting herself in with a chance.
It is Machado, in fact, and she's done a lot of running to get there. I think she was about 60 meters off this pace. So the Poles with two in the leading group, Panfil and Gradus, the Japanese with three, and the Portuguese with two. There's the motor, obviously doing a lot of thinking, I think, Lisa. She's looking around. I think she's either counting the numbers or wondering whether this is the point to go.
I think Rosa would like to be in the position to control the pace of this race. There are rumours that she is not 100% fit. How far off of 100%, I'm not sure. If she was 100% fit, you would pick her to win. But if she's not, if the rumours are true, then I would think that she would be hoping that she could control this pace and do what she wants with the race and not have anybody push it before she wants it pushed. She's been looking across a lot at the girl who's leading, and it makes you wonder if she's really comfortable with what's going on. On the other hand, maybe she's just biding her time. Maybe she's happy about it.
Well, she's used to being the boss.
She is, and at the moment she's not the boss here. So it just makes me wonder if perhaps she would have rather sat around at the lead a little bit longer and have them all tailing her. But I notice that Wanda Panfil sticks by Rosa. She doesn't bother with anyone else at the front.
Maris Biber. Looking very determined. And Brendan, they may be speeding up slightly. I don't know or whether Biber's giving us a false impression. But she's strong and running way inside her best time.
She certainly is running inside her best time, but I think her lack of international experience is beginning to show, because to run 2 or 3 yards ahead of the group, to be in the lead, just to be in the lead, is not really of any significance. And it's the more sensible ones who are just going to stay in the group. They're being directed now by the traffic police to get across to the other side of the road. And I think Biber, well, she looked to be sweating profusely, and I think this is possibly a last-ditch effort, because she didn't get away from the group. She certainly looked as though she was trying, couldn't do anything about it. And now the Japanese will have something to cheer with Yamashita into the lead. And Wanda Panfil's followed her. She's got Rosa Motor on her other side and Dora on her left-hand side. So the big names, the ones that we were expecting, the ones that we were tipping to run well, are in there running well. And if you notice, they all started their watch their own personal watches when they set off from the stadium. And I just noticed Dora checking her watch time. She's looking for the 19 kilometers mark. We can't see it, but she maybe can.
The athlete's been directed across the road by that traffic for that motorcycle policeman, who's knocked one of the bollards out of the way in his anxiety to get up to them and point the short way. But in a marathon, marathon runners rarely need to be told to go the short way.
It helps sometimes when there's a line painted on the course. At New York, they have a blue line painted for the entire length of the course, and if you run on that line, you're running the tangents. Funny that you should mention that you don't need to be pointed the way, because sometimes towards the end you can get so tired and so dizzy, delirious, that you don't look for the tangents and you run further than you have to. I personally like to have a line right on that course so I don't have to think.
This said, of course, that runners can be hypnotized by the line.
That's true too.
So not far to go to the 20 kilometer mark. And not far to go either to the halfway point at 21.
This is Maria Rebello Lelut from France. The best time of 2 hours and 29 minutes. And she's ahead of Cecil Grottenberg there, who's beginning to slow down, and I think Rebello Lelut is beginning to close the gap and move closer to that leading pack. Once you've been in the position that she's been in, Cecil Grottenberg, and you go off the pack, then you've got trouble. Number 691, the other Soviet Union athlete, Barangolova. Well, her best is 2 hours 30, but I think she's running a controlled and sensible race. And then Narlock, Brazil, just behind her there. We're not exactly sure how far they are behind the leading group, but I think they are about the third pack.
Machado's really put in some running, number 592, to get there. But I've just been listening to a fascinating story Lisa's been telling me. We were just talking to each other while Brenner was talking about the irritation of these vehicles. The motorcycle's not so bad, but the bigger vehicles are very oppressive to be surrounded by them. But what about that helicopter in the Los Angeles Olympics?
Just saying, motorcycles are fine, you can see around them. Large trucks make you feel really closed in, but there's nothing worse than a low-flying helicopter, which we had in the Los Angeles Olympics, blowing dust up off the road into the faces of the athletes and blowing cups off of tables at water stations. That was really bad, and then there was the wind resistance too. They came so low. At least there are no helicopters here.
Actually, they have got some aerial shots of a helicopter flying, but with these high-rise buildings, there's no chance of them blowing cups off the tables. And out in an industrial section of the city, light industry, this is called Peace Island. The island's reclaimed some years ago. And with Tokyo's need for buildings, this massive population, this capital city of over 20 million. There's the 20K mark in about 1 hour 10:52, Brendan, I think.
One hour, 10 minutes and 54 seconds by my calculations, which means that 5 kilometer stretch was 17:47. So that's a little slower than the earlier kilometers. But you can just tell it's a gentle pace, and I'm sure it's a tactic of getting to halfway by conserving as much energy as possible. And the group is just whittling. It's Yegorova at the back of that group. She got on earlier, and now she's just falling away again. And they're coming up to the halfway point. They'll all check the times at halfway. They'll all have a serious think about how they feel at halfway, and they'll all then begin to consider their tactics.
Halfway, almost in sight for some of them. Yegorova, who's suffering a little bit, did her no good actually losing ground at the feeding station, because when you have to work to get back, it's very disheartening, especially when you've lost ground for that reason.
Well, you can do all the training and you can do all the acclimatization, you can do all the preparation you want, but it's the second half. Once you get past halfway, then you know the answers to the questions. Bieber leading, I think, a little unnecessarily, unless she's getting herself in a position to take a drink, but she didn't seem to have done very well at that feeding station. Oh, there, she's just got plain water. Rosa Moda just taking the first significant drop of water, poured it straight on her head. She hasn't drunk much water.
Very noticeable then that Moda was determined to get to that water. In fact, she had to chop her stride. She had to pause very slightly to do it and lost a little bit of ground, but she was determined to get it. But just taking sips.
For all of her determination to get there, it hardly seemed worth her while to just take one sip and throw it. She really is feeling the heat, though, because then she bothered again to go in and get a cup and throw water over her head. If she was not feeling the heat and the humidity, she wouldn't have worried with that at all. Rosa does put flat Coca-Cola in her last few water bottles. I learned a few years ago, and then I tried it, because it does have high sugar content. She dilutes it. I'm not sure what the dilution is. In these conditions, I think it would be not very strong at all. But perhaps that's what she's got in her bottles today. She's not taking much of it, though.
10 together now. Still the three Japanese, the two Portuguese, the two Poles. What do you know about 575, Lisa? Camilla Gradus. She's run 226.55 this year, fifth in the Boston Marathon. She's only 24, so, I mean, obviously, she's still got a lot to come.
Yeah, she ran a really good performance at Boston. That was a very competitive race. That was a race where if you're in shape to run that sort of time, it would have been, I don't want to say easy to do it, but she had plenty of women to run with, a pack of them. I'm not sure how many marathons that she's run, but with a time like that, she should be in with a chance for a medal here.
Still got raised eyebrows at Machado's run. Coming from some way back, she was 60 metres behind the leading pack, we're told. And there's the turning point, the halfway stage. So we'll get a time as the leaders swing. And as Brenner's been suggesting, just inside at 2 hours 30. That's the turning point, by the way, for the vehicles. One of the athletes, one of the Japanese, mistook that.
There's a bit of confusion there among the athletes. One of the girls ran off that way and had to be guided back onto the course.
Vehicles being stopped, as you can see, about 100 metres further back, or perhaps 200 metres further back, and they're now approaching the halfway point. And the pace, clearly now over 2 hours 30.
That was interesting, though. Rosa Moda obviously knows this course pretty well. She started directing the traffic. She let the traffic go around that particular turn, and then she told the athletes that that wasn't where they were supposed to go. They had to keep on to this. You can hear the crowd beginning to chant now. They've got three Japanese in this leading group, and they're delighted about this. You can see the crowd swelling. They've obviously been at home watching the first part of this race on the television, and they come to the turn, 1 hour 15 and 37. Well, that's the turning point, but I'm not sure it's exactly halfway.
That's a good point now, Brendan, because the race now is, if that is the exact halfway point, they claim it is. I mean, they're over 2 hours 31.
Well, I don't think it's exactly halfway, because they run a couple of laps in the stadium before they went out, and on the way back they only run a lap and a quarter, so that'll be the difference in the stadium.
Yes, that makes sense. So the pace, as we've been suggesting, is still around 2.5 hours. The Brazilian in trouble, Narlock. It's going to be a lot of cramp. Oh, 281. Sally Eastall from St. Edmund Striders. Sticking in, finding it hard, but moving fairly smoothly.
She always runs conservatively, and in a big championship like this, and in conditions like this, that suits her, because others set off more ambitiously and either fall by the wayside, as we've seen. We saw number 74, Narlock, having a bit of trouble and stopping for a while. Sally Eastall just setting off at doing her own pace and just coming through gradually. And that's the right thing to do in these conditions, especially for an athlete like Sally, who's not all that experienced internationally. But she's running well. She's coming up to the turn now. She's running very, very well indeed.
That is Sally's best time, 2 hours 36. So she's inside that. We've seen one or two athletes now, apparently with stomach cramp, Lisa, but it's not just going to be stomach cramp. There'll be a lot of cramp in these humid conditions.
I'm sure there will be, with loss of electrolytes, stomach cramps especially, because of the blood going to the limbs to help a person run and just the lack of blood supply to the stomach area. Every time I look at Machado, I just wish I could tie that hair up. I keep feeling she'd be so much cooler if she could get that hair off of her neck.
Machado, 5.92. And no water for Rosa Moto. Harry Mori, 4.58. I've got to say that for a very inexperienced marathon runner, but she's a national record holder, this is her third marathon. She looks very well organized. 6.91 is Barangalova of the Soviet Union. .457, Araki of Japan. And that's quite a significant move by the Soviet athlete, who's been off the pace, and it looks as if the leaders are slowing slightly.
Well, I think she was off the pace deliberately so, because she gradually moved her way through. She passed Grottenberg just a kilometre or so ago and moves up to the back of the pack, running smoothly, running strongly. Bieber still leading. I feel she's leading a bit unnecessarily, and I think that's her lack of international experience. But time will tell. And if you look at in the group there, we've seen Panfil have a little go at the front. We've seen Rosa Moto try and dominate the race from the front. But we've seen Dore just in the group, not done anything about it at all. And Barangalova just coming up on the outside. Maybe she's going to go into the lead, but I think past the halfway stage, I think it's a case of just checking it out, just seeing how you feel. There's an awful long way to go here, and obviously the second half of the race is tougher physically because of the pressure, but it's also tougher because of these conditions. It's warming now.
Interesting that Barangalova, and also earlier Machado of Portugal, caught the leaders without any apparent difficulty.
Kilometers was as slow as 5 kilometers, and perhaps that explains why the others were able to join the lead group without too much difficulty.
In terms of pace, the story of the race was that the first 5 kilometers was running 17:56, and then the second 5 kilometers 17:40, so it was speeding up. The third 5 kilometers 17:30, and then they slowed the second slowest one to 17:47, and I think that was because they were just checking it out and just feeling it, beginning to feel the effect of the temperature and the humidity, but also beginning to feel that they're quite happy in this group. They're not interested in times. They'll go elsewhere in the spring and autumn marathons for their times. They'll run the big city marathons like London or Boston or New York, or even the one in Tokyo itself, which is held in November, if they want to run a fast time. But today is about championships. And I think the Japanese spectators will be really excited to see three Japanese in this leading group.
Getting a check on the splits. Because the splits Brendan's given you takes you deeper into the race at the moment. Still three Japanese in the leading pack, the two Germans, the two Portuguese, and now the Soviet athlete, Barangalova, having come from a long way back, a best time of 2 hours 30:41. So she's inside that sort of pace. Seventh in this year's London Marathon. Looking quite aggressive.
Well, she just kept going at the pace she was going at before she caught the group. and I feel this is the first question mark that I would have over Rosa Mota. Normally when she's 100% and when she's in a race to win like this, she dominates the race by the position she assumes. Now she's being shunted into the second row there. She's allowing the Soviet Union athlete to get that few yards ahead. That may not be a significant move in itself, but I just feel the ambience of Rosa Mota is a little different today than when she's run some of her greatest races. I certainly hope she can do it today, moving on the outside of her teammate Machado. I think she's even talking to her and telling her what to do. But I think maybe moving out of that group, I hope that's the right thing to do, and I hope that Rosa can just get herself in a better position.
Well, having caught the leading group, having gone at her own pace, she's arrived there confident enough to take it on. Just drifted past them. So, okay, I've got there. She's not taking a breather.
I'm surprised the group are letting her go a little bit. And as Brendan was saying, Rosa is running a different sort of race now. She's not being aggressive. She's not being super confident. I would have thought from a purely psychological point of view that she would lead this group all the way if she could, to be out in front dominating and dictating the pace, but she's not doing that.
Rocky struggling and being caught by Lalou. Lalou. Bronze medalist in the European Championships behind Mota and Yagarova. And Rosa Mota has moved away from that group, getting a clear run for herself. I don't know what she's been looking around at, but I saw her glance up at one of the spectator stands or a balcony as she went by, and then she looked at somebody in the crowd, almost as if she was looking for someone.
Quite possible that she did have a plan with, say, her coach of where he would be on the course, and perhaps she's looking to him for some guidance. She does often do that in races. A little strange what she's doing at the moment. She moved over to the other side of the road, and now she's moving back with everybody else, and she's lost some contact. I really don't like the look of that for Rosa. In fact, she's lost quite a bit of contact.
And also significant that her stride is shortening, and there's no real power there at the moment.
To be perfectly honest, I think she has gone. She doesn't look good. Rosa would not let this happen if she was feeling good. She would be with that group.
Well, I know approaching this race, she was always in two minds. And we've been talking to her about coming to the Northeast in 2 weeks, 3 weeks' time to run in the Great North Run. She gave us an initial answer to say that she would run, but then she changed her mind slightly and said that it would depend on her performance today. Now, this is not Rosa Mota dominating the races we've seen before. When you remember that she won this last time by 7 minutes, won the Olympic Games, won the last three European Championship marathons, never has she given anyone the initiative like she's given them here. She slipped off the group there, went across the other side. We don't know quite why she did that, but now, is Rosa Mota in trouble? My feeling is she probably is.
Well, Barangalova in front is really asking the questions now. Mota, the world champion, the Olympic champion, the European champion, back after a stomach operation. And possibly, Lisa, back too soon?
I'm really not sure. She ran very well in London. Then apparently she had an ovarian cyst removed, the size of a grapefruit, they said, and also had her appendix out. So how quickly you can recover from that, I'm not sure. I think she had three and a half months to get ready for this race. I heard that she was very confident. She said she would be ready in time, but then I also heard rumours here that she was not 100% fit, and by the look of this, she is not 100% fit. Whether it was the operation, whether there were other problems with her training, I'm not sure.
Well, I wonder what's going through her mind now. Is it worth it?
I think that would be going through her mind, and whether she should continue running, come into the stadium in 10th, 11th place, something like that, or whether she should drop out. The other thing is that over this distance in heat like this, and it's almost 25 degrees Celsius now, 60% humidity, you can do a lot of damage by continuing to run, and it could take her an awful long time to recover from this. Perhaps she'll be thinking that maybe she should drop out and run a marathon later in the year, because if she really has lost contact, if she can't get back with these girls, she's going to do a lot of physical damage by continuing.
Well, I think Wanda Panfil will have noticed that Rosa Mota's gone. They'll all feel that now it's up to one of them to take the initiative. She doesn't look to be straining excessively, but she would never put herself in this position by choice. Her stride seems to be shortening. She looks a bit tired on her legs, which is a rare sight for Rosa Mota. This is not Rosa at her very, very best. She's the great championship runner for the marathon. She is a respecter of championships, so, you know, it may not be sensible for her to keep pushing all the way, but, it, you know, she may be the sort who just runs a race till she finishes. And then the other Polish athlete dropped off the group, Wanda Panfil, having a good look round there to see whether Rosa Mota is anywhere in contention, and I think that was the sign for her to press on and take the initiative and start leading them. Dora follows her immediately, and you can sense that the pace is accelerating.
Rangelova suddenly in trouble. I think Panfil realised, you're quite right, that Mota was in trouble and made the move that brought the pack back to the Soviet athlete and now is keeping the pressure on.
She's really making the running now. I think when she realised that Rosa was out of it, she must have got pretty excited because that narrowed things down quite a bit with her out of contention. Katrin Dore, I'm surprised, is also there running really aggressively. Her fitness must have improved a lot since July. I'm not sure how she'll handle this heat.
Champion of the world, probably watching her title disappearing in the distance. Rosa, also the Olympic champion, three times the European champion. Panfil leading, Dora in second place, and third, this young Japanese, Arimura. Yamashita just behind her, then Machado, Biber, Varangalova of the Soviet Union. And gradually, the leading group growing smaller.
And when you think about it, Panfil will have been preparing, thinking about Rosa Mota. How can I beat her? When will I make my move? Can I beat her in the later stages, or will I have to run away from her? Can I out-sprint her on the track? All these things will have gone through her mind in training, because Rosa had that influence and has that influence on the world of marathon running. And all of a sudden, to find Rosa Mota out of it, and now taking on drinks, but out of it, and the race hasn't really become that competitive yet, then I think the psychological boost that Wanda Panfil and Katrin Dore will have received will be of real significance to them now.
That's Lalou, the French girl, who got the bronze medal behind Mota in the European Championships last year in Split. Mota looks across and recognises Lalou. And really, she's going back very quickly.
She's going back very quickly, and it's still a long way to run. It's going to be a long race for Rosa now.
I suspect, actually, when we saw her looking up and probably looking for a coach, as you said, Lisa, he's always somewhere around the course and pops up at various points. She's probably saying, what about it? Is it worth it?
I think they must have discussed before this race, if she wasn't feeling good, if she lost contact, what her plan would be, and they must have known that she was not 100% fit, so obviously they've considered this option.
So the Japanese have lost one in the leading group. Iraqi's way back. But Barangalova, having caught the leading group and gone successfully ahead by maintaining the same pace, I think Panfil, once she realised that Mota was struggling, made the move that took the leaders away and caught the Soviet athlete. It's not so much that Varangalova's changed her pace pattern, she's just off the back there. I think the others are making the attack.
Well, we said about the effect that Rosa Mota dropping off would have on the rest of the group, but I think it's also so early in the race yet that it's a case of just controlling yourself and just settling down. Panfil, Dora, Arimori, Yamashita, Machado, and Biber, and that's the group where the winner's going to come from. I think Panfil's an experienced enough marathon runner to know that she shouldn't make a long rush for home yet. Barungalova now just dropped off that group, came through, went past them all, and then just slowed, and they came past her. Gradas, Rebello Lalut, and then Rosa Mota. Coming into these games, you would have had to say that Rosa Mota was one of the one of the strongest favourites, but that's a record that's speaking for itself there, not her current fitness.
Some news of the British at the halfway point. Sally Eastall is back in 18th place, 1 hour 16 minutes 32. Sally Ellis is 22nd, 1 hour 17 minutes and 8 seconds. And Veronique Marrow, right with her, just a second behind in 23rd place, 1 hour 17 minutes and 9 seconds. So the Britons 18th, 22nd and 23rd.
Two Germans, two Japanese, one Pole and one Portuguese athlete. And surprisingly enough, it's the other Portuguese athlete, Machado. And there's some tourists having a ride around Japan on the morning of the marathon. There's an awful lot of cars on this course. Buses, bikes. They seem to be enjoying themselves going zigzagging in and out of the way of the runners, but it's no fun for the runners. And if you suddenly start thinking about it and worrying about it, it can really can affect you, because motorbikes running alongside you, you know it's not doing any good having all the fumes going into your face. And I think it's a real nuisance, a real irritation, and a little bit unnecessary.
Leading six. It looks at the moment as if three of them will get the gold, silver and bronze from that leading six. Barangalova is losing quite a bit of ground on that leading group now.
Well, Panfil's obviously feeling good, feeling strong. Obviously feels as though she can start to run away from them in her time, when she wants to, how she wants to. But it's a calculation now. It's a calculation about how far out she wants to commit herself. If she really is feeling as strong as she looks, there's no need to do it yet. There's no times at stake. There's nothing at stake except the gold medal. And the Poles feel that Wanda Panfil is their best hope of a gold medal in these championships. She's smiling at some of her friends, either on the side of the road. Machado is obviously quite enjoying herself. So they're obviously getting good support from the side of the road. And I think this is probably because they're coming back towards the athletes' village. The athletes have all turned out. They probably weren't around supporting them on the way out at 7:15, but on the way back at about just after 8 o'clock, I think they'll definitely be there giving them a hand, giving them some support.
And Panfil making the break by the look of it. Machado going with her. Had time for a smile at someone in the crowd a short time ago, the Portuguese.
Machado's been smiling a lot. She looks in control. Wanda is such a confident runner, and this is still very early in the race to be making such a move. She must be feeling very good.
Actually, we didn't get a split for you at 25 kilometres because the cameras were concentrating on Rosa Mota down the field. But the impression must be that they are speeding up slightly. Well, that's interesting. Now, we've seen that male runner earlier, Lisa. Do you remember? It's the same chap who was running along the pavement.
Yes, I do recognise him. Rosa has just stopped.
And I think the significance of that conversation was that he's something to do with the motor camp and he's told her to pull out.
He must be, but that's not her coach, say Pedrosa, but Rosa is out of this race.
So,
well, that's a sad sight to see Rosa Mota, the world champion, the European champion, the Olympic champion, everyone's favourite for the marathon, the much respected, one of the most respected distance runners in the world, having to succumb to probably her fitness, which was in question before this race. It obviously wasn't the conditions, but she never looked to be trying to dominate this race as she's done in the past.
Actually, you look back, this is her first major title defeat in a major international race since the Olympic Games in 1984. And that's a another member of the entourage having a word with her. But she was third in the Olympic Games in Los Angeles, and that's the last defeat she suffered in a major international title race. Three times the European champion, the Olympic champion, the reigning world title holder, but we'll have a new world champion today.
Quite surprisingly there, David, she dropped out right on cue at the athlete's village where she's staying. So she went past it on the way out, turned and then came back and absolutely spot on, just dropped out at the bottom of the drive. So there was obviously some calculation in that.
Absolutely. I think when she passed it the first time, she was in contention.
I think when she passed it the first time, she was thinking about whether she should drop out that time because she was in just beginning to have some trouble.
Japanese interest me, actually, running on home ground. That one on the inset is some way back, Araki. But the two dangerous ones are 458 Aribori and 481 Yamashita. Motorcycle camera catching up quickly. To check on the leading group, Machado of Portugal in the green shorts, in the red, Panfil, in the cap, Dora of Germany, the two Japanese, Arimori, 458, Yamashita, 481. And the other German, the German at the back there, 321, is Abiba. We've got two Germans, two Japanese, a Pole, and a Portuguese. Machado is an experienced athlete. She's 28, the Portuguese. But form plays a major part in marathons, especially when they've got 1 or 2 miles on the clock in races already. And 2:33.8, her best time set this year. She looks very comfortable.
If you look at Wanda Panfil, she's won her last four marathons. She hasn't lost a marathon since 1989, and she ran the fastest time in the world this year earlier in Boston. She won New York last year. She won London last year. She missed out on the European Championships, and Rosa Mota took that one. And she won Nagoya in 1990. She finished sixth in Chicago in 1989, and that was the last race she lost. So her current form is pretty impressive.
Approaching 30 kilometres, so we'll get some idea of the pace, get some idea of too whether this leading group's just staying on at the same pace or has speeded up. Now, Lisa, take your pick.
Don't do this to me. Wanda Panfil looks good. The Japanese girls will run until they drop, I know that much, especially with the championships being here in Tokyo. I'm surprised that Machado is still there. Of all of these girls, she's the least likely one to stay there with a personal best of 2:33. She's running the race of her life. If I had to put my money on someone, it would be Wanda Panfil at this stage, and I'd bet a Japanese to be in there at the end. Catherine Dore is surprising me because she looked so bad in early July when she ran in Sapporo, but after that she left. She went to Switzerland. She's been training at Davos, and she must have put in a lot of good work because she's still in here and she's looking okay.
Dore on the cap on the far side, being followed by our German teammate Bieber, or Bieber it should be, in sunglasses. Actually, the youngest one of that group is Arimori, 24, young for a marathon runner. Right in the centre of the picture now. Working hard to stay there, but she's had a look of total concentration all the way through, and has never appeared to be really trouble. You've got to admire this run by Arimori. Only two previous marathons.
And you can imagine the pressure that she's under here. The expectation of the Japanese public. They really enjoy their marathon running. They've got a great tradition of marathon running. Sometimes I think they transmit that pressure to the athletes a little bit too much. If you remember, Subba Raya finished second in the 1964 Olympic Games after finishing sixth in the 10,000 meters. He was their only medalist the 64 Games. And then he felt a few years afterwards that he'd let down the Japanese public by his performance in not winning the gold medal. He finished second behind Abebe Bikila, and there was no chance that anybody in the world was ever going to beat Abebe Bikila at his best. And very, very sadly, Subba Raya never recovered from that feeling of shame and committed suicide a few years later. And his suicide note said that he felt as though he'd betrayed the Japanese nation in those 64 games in Tokyo. So that's just some indication of the expectation that the Japanese put on the marathon runners. And hopefully these women have been able to avoid that, because they didn't come into this race as favorites. They came in with some form, and with some very good form actually, but they didn't come in hopefully with that pressure of expectation.
Well, Ari Mori, I've just been doing some checking, was second in the Osaka Marathon. That was only her second marathon ever. She was sixth the year before. She was second this year in the Osaka Marathon, when she set the Japanese best time of 2 hours, 20 minutes and 1 second. And she was beaten in that race by Dore of Germany, who is in that lead group. Dore that day clocked 2 hours, 27:43.
Actually, Dore's got a tremendous record in Japan. She's run quite amazingly. She's run in Osaka in 1991 this year, where she won, as you said. She finished first on this course in Tokyo in 87, finished second on this course in 86. She won in Nagoya in 86. She won in Tokyo in 85. She won in Hiroshima in 85. She won in Tokyo in 84. And she won in Osaka in 84 itself. So she's run most of her races in Japan, and she's won 7 out of her 8 races in Japan. This Tokyo Marathon, though, this course that she's run on here, she's finished first, second, and first in 85 and first in 84. She's got the best time of 2:25 on this course, and she's won this race in 2:34. So she's won in this on this course, and with times 9 minutes apart. And I think that probably tells you how the conditions here can affect the race. And here she is, she knows the course well. And there she is for the first time making a move. Coming up to 30 kilometers. We'll check the time at 30 kilometers, but at the moment, it's Dora taking a slight advantage for the first time, coming out of the pack, putting her head down and letting them know that she's there. The split from 25 kilometers, 1 hour and 28 minutes.
Almost on the 30 kilometer point. Brendan with pencil and paper out, and we'll be able to give you the split times and whether, in fact, the leading group speeded up in the last 10,000 metres or not. Actually, from 20 to 25, it was the slowest one so far, 17:54. Although, no, not that much slower, though, Brendan.
No, it wasn't much slower, but we'll just check it. 30 kilometers, where we feel as though there's just a slight bit of pressure being exerted, both by Dora and Panfil. Panfil is obviously more concerned about the group, and Dora seems a bit concerned about staking her claim.
Well, the race started at 7 o'clock local time. We set out to the commentary position at 6 o'clock local time under the impression that conditions were good. How wrong we are.
Looks as if it's almost 26 degrees Celsius, just a little under 60% humidity, but those are really tough conditions for a marathon, and it's showing on these girls.
It really has built up, Lisa, though. You were saying on the way here, I wouldn't mind running today in this, but what about it now?
I'm hot sitting here. Brendan, why are you sweating so much? Katrin Dore looks good here. She's lost a lot of weight since she was running in Japan in July, and she's really controlling this race at the moment.
We'll give you the various 5,000 meter splits in a moment. On the last 5,000, Brendan.
Well, it's quite difficult to work them out this time of the morning, but that was 17:48 5 kilometers, so that was slightly faster than the previous one, and I think the race is beginning to happen, and it's beginning to happen quite seriously. Dora is just doing enough to press the pace, and I think if there's any weak link in this group of five, well, I think we'll find out as they come past the oriental part, the Shinjuku Jojoji Temple. I had a bit of difficulty saying that, but that's the older part, the oriental part of Tokyo, where the shrine is, and people come and visit from all over the place. But there is Dora setting off now, beginning to start to apply the pressure. And I think the course advantage, her knowledge of this course, her knowledge of running in similar conditions to this, I think this is where she hopes will come to her advantage.
This is the most scenic part of the route. They come back towards the Imperial Palace. Gradus of Poland, we expected to make an impact, but she's lost touch. Not the sixth fastest time in the world this year. Varangilova behind her, the Soviet Union, has lost a lot of ground in the last 5,000 metres. It's Biber now of Germany in trouble, the leading group down to five. And Biber looking very heavy-legged.
She does, but again, she was running well above herself for the first half of this race. I think her personal best time is 2:30 and a half. And these are really tough conditions. They're running around 2:30 pace now. Still really surprised by Machado, who's still in there. And her personal best is 2:33. She's looking okay, but she's at the tail of this lead group. Two Japanese girls still there looking good.
I think Dora's demonstrated fantastic control, because when there were 12 in the group, you had to look to see where she was, because she was just in there and almost anonymous. But as the group fell apart, and as the group went down from 12 to 10 to 8, now to 5, for the first time Dora gets into the lead, and you can see she means business. Machado just beginning to struggle. It comes on very slowly. You just see a sign of it. They lose a stride or two. A small gap opens and begins to happen. So it's Dora, Panfil, and the two Japanese. And if you think about it, the Japanese best performance in the World Championships was a sixth place last time. It looks like they've got two chances of beating that, and they've got two chances of a medal.
It'll be a long way home for Biber, facing the last 10,000 metres now of the race. The leaders, just around 6 miles to go.
It's a long 6 miles. I think there's an old saying in marathon running, Lisa, that the race doesn't start till you get past 20 miles.
All I know is the race doesn't end till you pass the finish line. I think even the last 400 metres of a marathon can be tough. There's still a long way to go in this race, but it looks as if the Japanese have such a good chance of coming away from this with a medal. They deserve it too. They've had a good history, a good tradition of marathon running in Japan.